Yes, sir. We'll start the session, sir. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of NNF Karnataka, myself, Dr. Prashant Gowda, Secretary NNF State Chapter, we would like to welcome Mr. Nilesh Shinde, Anu Kaushik, and Dr. Shilpa. And we have extremely good panelists as well. So to introduce Nilesh Shinde, I request Ganesh to give a brief introduction and start the session. After that, I request Kishore Kumar, sir, to give introduction about Dr. Shilpa and Anu Kaushik. Over to you, Ganesh. Ganesh, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there, sir. So, good evening, everyone. I think it's a pleasure to welcome Nilesh. Nilesh is a dear friend. Known him for close to two decades. He used to work very closely with us in GE, and then he moved on to the hospital sector. And he's credited to build two 500-bed hospitals for Jupiter, and of course he has supported many other hospitals, you know, across you know, Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat, and of course level very deep, you know, incited person, and you know, he has hands-on experience in almost everything. His recent claim to fame, I should say, is that you know, he was part of building that COVID, the 1,000-bed COVID hospital in Mumbai, in Worli. I think he led the project right from the front and did it in record time. And this is as much I know. I'm sure he's done much more than all of this. And I think to hear from him will be a huge opportunity for all of us to understand, number one, to do things in the right way. What are the process, protocols, guidelines? And number two, also to do it in quick time, because in many times in hospital projects, delays cost more money, and you know, it's a drain. And I have seen all of their projects. I have closely worked with them, you know, from a supplier side. You know, bang on, they will start in time. You know, fulfillment, meticulous planning, and pulling in resources, and of course, being above board always, and always looking at patient care safety. Has been the top priority. So that's why I requested him, and he has agreed to be part of this. So over to you, Nilesh.
Okay, thanks, organizer, for giving me opportunity to give this presentation. And also, I would like to thank Mr. Ganesh, whom I know from last two decades, from my GE days. And I would like to tell everyone that I'm not a consultant in a fire alarm system, but my hands-on experience in on each and every services, though whatever experience we are having in last 15 years in this healthcare industry, like today I will give some presentation out of that, and I'm sure you will get some input from there. And there are experts who are there, and it's always there. Once we are sharing something, you always learn also at that time. So that is always a good procedure and a process. So shall I start my presentation, or I have to wait? Can I start my presentation?
Yes, please go ahead.
Sir, yes, sir. Sir, yes, okay, sir, please.
Okay, yeah, just. So you can see that? Hello?
Yes, we can see here. Yeah.
Okay. So I will go. So I'm going to cover on the fire alarm systems in hospital. Hello?
Yes, proceed, please.
Yeah, so we are looking, I'm looking for fire alarm system in hospitals. If you see in hospital, there are a lot of alarms are coming, and fire is one of the important alarm system in hospital. So when we are designing some hospital, it is always like when we design a fire is important, plays important role, because one of the license which we require is a fire NOC also before starting of the hospital. And fire is a thing where you have to act proactively. So we should not wait till like with the approach of Chalta Hai. We cannot do in that way. You have to make sure that fire system, fire alarm system is there, as well as firefighting system is there properly installed and maintained properly in hospital. So I will go to my next slide. So what is fire? So typically fire comes from chemical reaction between oxygen in the atmosphere, then some sort of fuel is required along with that, and which catch the fire. And when it happens, fuel must be heat to its ignition temperature. And when that happens, if you can see in typically wood fire, this is the way the fire happens. Okay. So what are different types of fires? So fire class, I have written here A, B, C, D, E, F, K. There are different symbols for that. Then what is get covered in fire class A? Is a solid substance. What happens in future, like is a glow and flames come, as well as example for that is that food, paper, textiles. In B is a liquid, feature is flame. An example is oil, gas line, and fats. When it comes to fire C, it is gases, feature is flames, disturbed gases, butane, propane, and natural gases. D is like custom oil metal, feature is again glow and flames, and example is magnesium, aluminum, and sodium. E stands electrical, liquid, or solid substance, feature is glow and flames, and example is plastic. And F is oil fats, basically we see in cooking oils, frying fat, in kitchen, disturb of fire can happen. Now, when we are saying fire safety system, so what is meaning of fire safety system? One is fire detection and alarm system, and second is fire protection system. So what is meaning of fire detection alarm system and fire protection system? We will go into depth of that. So when we are saying fire alarm system, there are two types of alarm system. One is conventional one, one is addressable one. What do you mean by conventional one is that, like earlier era, or maybe most of the places also still it has been done, that one of the zone they will consider, and those, if something happens there in that much zone, there are a lot of smoke detectors are there, maybe in one zone of maybe 400 to 500 square feet area or more than that, if there is a smoke detectors are there, then whenever we get a message on our fire alarm panel in a conventional one, we can't able to make out. Yes, we can able to make out there is a zone and zone is having issue, but we cannot make out which exactly which alarm system or detector is having an issue or which detector has sensed the fire. We cannot able to make out. This is a conventional well, and addressable ones means very exactly whatever, maybe like we in our hospital, we are having more than 1200 smoke detectors. So in addressable way, we can able to make out exactly pinpoint which point there is a fire alarm has been detected, and whether it's a false alarm or there is a real fire, we can able to make out very fast, because that what happens because of this addressable fire alarm system, you can able to pinpoint sitting at the one location where we are having fire alarm system, sitting at that location, we can able to see everything. So, and we can able to act fast, our fire response team can able to act fast in case of this addressable fire alarm system. Now there are different types of standards which are used in fire alarm system. One is IS 2189, that is Indian standard for selection, installation and maintenance of automatic fire detection and alarm system. Second one is BS 539, fire detection alarm system for building part one. Third one is NBC, and fourth is NFPA 72. This is NFPA 72 is the National Fire Alarm Code, USA, NBC 260 or 2016. Most of the, now that depends on the how consultants are going to follow this type of fire alarm system. Now, along with the fire alarm system, whatever we follow, and the region where this hospital is going to be installed or where the fire alarm system is going to be installed, there you can able to do with the help of the services consultant as well as the local fire authority department, you can able to design your own fire alarm system. But fire alarm system will be based on these four standards which are given here. So how fire alarm system works? So first thing is that input device. What do you mean by input devices? Input devices for detection of fire. So how it will be detected? There are detectors are there, their manual call points are there. These are the input device, monitor modules are there. These are the called as input devices for fire alarm system. Now process, now once this fire alarm system has detected something, how it will be, how it will get implemented, how we'll come to know that what to do next. So that will pass with the process, understand and implement logic sequence. So the sequence has been defined and it has stored in this type of fire alarm panel. Okay. And then there has to be output device, means once this has happened, once it has been detected, and now we have to able to inform to the entire people who are there in hospital. So that we require an output device. So we can able to with the voice or maybe fly, we can able to, or with the different type of tones, we can able to tell everyone that there is a fire and you need to act or on that issue. So what is fire safety system? So fire system, if you see that at the left side corner, there is a fire pump. So this fire pump always has to be there. Now fire pump is very, very important, because if you have seen that when we go to any place, we can able to see the sprinkler, or we can able to see the smoke detector. Most of the time the smoke detectors are glowing. Sometimes if it is showing red alarm, that means there is some issue and someone has to address that issue. But okay, if there is a fire alarm has happened now, and if there is a real fire, then smoke detector also has to active, or it has to give the sprinkler the water. But what happens that for that, for your entire line has to be charged completely with whatever, like 6.5 kg per square meter, centimeter square pressure, or maybe 9.5 for hydrant. Now fire pump, which is there, if you see on the left side corner, is a fire pump is there. It has to be there always on auto mode. It cannot be on a manual mode. So we have to, as a, whenever it gets installed, it is always there in auto mode. But down the line during the maintenance, sometimes it happens that it is there in manual mode. So it should not be in manual mode. It has to be always there in auto mode only. Now fire pump, that will cater to both hydrant as well as sprinkler. So hydrant normally is there in the fire escape staircases throughout, from the basement level up to the terrace, and sprinklers are the thing which are there everywhere across the hospital. So what happens there? So hydrant, like as we tell, as we told that it is having peripheral, also hydrants are been put so that in case of fire we can able to give the more pressure for the outside area, and sprinkler has to be there inside each and every location where can we can able to, in case of fire, it can able to sprinkle the water immediately. Now there is a gas suppression units also, because if you see that gas suppression and portable extinguisher, most of times we are having portable extinguisher here in various places, like there is a ABC type, there is a dry power type, there is a clean agent. So this type of different portable extinguisher, then CO2 is there in electrical equipment area. So that is there as a portable extinguisher. And there is a kitchen hood suppression. Now this is very, very important, that if you see that this is a UL listed hood suppression or fire suppression system should be there for kitchen. The reason is that because in kitchen there is suddenly fire can happen and you cannot able to control that with just the help of sprinkler. Sprinkler is not a right thing to do it, because what happens that most time the temperature goes above 70 and a sprinkler can get activated, and it can go may not be because of just because of fire, but because of flame, and with the temperature increase, sprinkler can become active. And if sprinkler become active, and wherever there is a kitchen area where the oil is there, it is more dangerous. So what we use, that special type of detector has been used in kitchen areas with hood suppression has been used in kitchen. This is the ideal way for using in kitchen with UL listed vendor. Now if you see here in the kitchen fire suppression system, so what happens that you can see there utensils which are there exactly on top of that. That is a hood there which can take out, that is exhaust hood which takes out the smoke and heat which is created there to outside. But if there is a fire there, there is a system involved, a fire suppression system. This is very, very important that immediately there is an advanced heat detectors are installed inside a fumigant hood who can trigger in the case of fire only. And these type of system are very, very important if there is a suddenly if you want to keep control the fire which is there on the kitchen or pantry side. Now, as we discussed earlier, that is a what is meaning of conventional panel and address panel. Now, this is what is a conventional panel. If you see there in conventional panels, it's very difficult to make out. There is a zone alarms will be there, but that zone alarms will give you like if just example zone 1, zone 1, zone 2, zone 3. So it will give that yes, in zone 2, there is an alarm, and you need to go there and see that how to take care of that. But what happens in case of fire, if you are having conventional panels, sometimes it becomes very, very difficult to go in that zone and find out. It's not practically possible. So normally nowadays addressable panel facility has been a panel has been used, and that will always give you a clear indication where is a fire, and you can able to tackle that issue very fast. So now important is that when we are saying fire alarm system, the first thing is come is smoke detector. Now there is always a question is that where to put smoke detector, where to put heat detectors. So that is always there. So normally smoke detectors are put in office area or wherever equipments are there, and heaters like heat detectors are used in car parking, electrical panel room, kitchen, pantry. Then LPG gas leak detector is used in kitchen. Then CO sensor is normally used in fire pump area, parking, DG set, room area. Now, if you see the detector, there is always a question that what should be the distance between two smoke detectors? So two smoke detectors shall not exceed more than 7.5 meter. So this is the, and this is not a norm for me, this is normal norms which are there, which we need to consider while spacing the detector. So under any flat ceilings, the horizontal distance is 7.5 meters between two smoke detectors and 5.3 meter in case of heat detector. Now detectors shall not be mounted within 500 mm of any wall. So if any wall is there or partition obstruction is there, there should not, like smoke detection should be away from 500 mm. So it is 0.5, which is almost when we are saying 1 meter is around 3 feet. So it is more than that. So 300 mm is 1 feet. So 500 mm is around just near to 2 feet area distance should be there. It should be should not be mounted within 500 mm. So similarly, if there is an obstruction like beams, if there are deeper beams are there. So if there is a like consider the case that most of the cases the beams is somewhere around more than 400 mm and overall ceiling height is only 3.5 meter. So it is more than 10% of that, the beam size. Okay, so in that case, we need to consider that as a wall, and we have to consider that is a two different bay, and we have to consider two different bay, and we have to put two different detectors there. Then detector shall not be mounted within 1 meter of any air inlet or forced ventilation system. So if there is an air inlet is there or forced ventilation system is there, we should not mount anything within 1 meter of that area. Then one more thing, like if you consider that most of the time the floor to floor distance is somewhere around 3.9 meter. Okay. And if it is more than 3.9 meter, if it is distance between floor to floor, now we are having a rough ceiling on the top, which is the ceiling, which is a RCC ceiling is there. Normally we put false ceiling there. So what happens there? If there is a gap between the ceiling, which is there, the RCC ceiling and false ceiling, if it is more than 800 mm, what is meaning of that? If my floor to floor distance is 3.9 meter, that means 3,900 mm. And if you are keeping false ceiling at 3,000 mm distance, that is 3 meter. So what is the distance between the ceiling, the main ceiling and false ceiling? It is 900 mm. So it is more than 800 mm. So as per the norms, if this is the case, then we need to make it sure that smoke detector, we need to put it above the ceiling, above the false ceiling and below the false ceiling also. So this is mandatory nowadays. So please make sure that if your distance is more than 800 mm, you need to put both sprinkler and smoke detector above and below the ceiling. Similarly, like there is no need of putting bathroom, lavatory or WC is not needed to put detector there. For any irregular shaped areas, the spacing between detectors and any point of the area is not greater than 0.7 times the determined spacing. Now, this is also very important that height limit. Smoke detectors can be used height up to 10 meter. Okay, beyond 7 meter height, heat detectors are not allowed. And beyond 10 meter height, only beam detectors and aspiring time of detectors shall be used. Optical beam detectors shall be installed at every 15 meter. So this is for height limits, what is there for smoke as well as for optical beam detector. No choice of detectors. Computer or IT center or other electronic equipments which have high value should be protected by smoke detectors or combination of smoke of heat detectors. Heat detectors are suitable in areas like where the heat producing equipment like kitchen and pantry. And LPG gas leak detector can be used in kitchen. Then along with the detector, there are two types of detector. Normally we say that analog detector, then digital detector, as well as we are also having an intelligent detector. So what is meaning of that? So analog detector is something like that, which is having a fixed threshold is been given there. So analog detector will give that signal to the panel. But then panel, the fire alarm panel is a decision maker. So in that case, fire alarm panel has becomes a decision maker and it then says and detects whether we have to give the output to us, like whether we have to give that signal or not, or we have to just consider that as a false signal. So that depends on the panel and not on the analog detector. Analog detector is a detector which gives the signal, which just pass it on their signal to the panel decision maker and panel become decision maker. But in case of digital, which is most of the European countries are using, like in India also a lot of people are using intelligent detectors. So what is meaning of that? One is that microprocessor and that is also having a profile. So what happens in that, the microprocessor and profile? So when intelligent detector are having microprocessor, it can able to detect and it can able to sense its own profile. So maybe after selection of all these profiles, it makes its own decision and it pushes that decision or signal to panel. And it is become very fast. You can able to come to, panel comes to conclusion that now what next action need to be taken in case of there is a fire. So it immediately able to understand whether it's a false alarm or whether able to, it can also able to sense that whether we have to act fast and we have to activate the entire fire fighting system. So this is the advantage of this digital intelligent detectors which are there. Now there are manual call points are also there. So manual call points shall be located in the area. No person in the premises has to travel distance of more than 30 meters to reach them. So manual call point is something like that. In case of fire, we normally say that we have to switch off lights and everything. So in that case, it should be accessible so fast that we should not able to travel for more than 30 meters to access that. So normally it is always kept near to the staircase of every level. Then if it is at the external of the building, then travel distance shall be 45 meter. When necessary, travel distance may require to be reduced less than 30 meter when there is a difficulty in free access or potentially dangerous risk. And call point shall be fixed at a height of 1.4 meter above the surrounding floor level. So this was for a manual call point. Now this is okay. That is one thing is that we are having fire alarm system, we are having sprinkler, we are having smoke detector. they will do their work definitely, but we should also have a fire management plan exist in hospital. This is very, very important, because like the way we are having for all other critical areas like ICU and for cath lab, we are having always a contingency plan. So similarly for fire management also in hospital, we have to have a contingency plan. So what is meaning of that? So in our hospital, we have done that. What should be the aim of this fire safety management plan? It's to address that management of fire safety effectively to different type of plan. Then it will always define that what are the general and specific duties of employees and what are they supposed to do during the fire emergency call, as well as there should be a definite procedure for dealing with disturbed emergency. So what is normally like for the extinguishing fire? Normally it is there is a race, like if there is a fire, the first thing which would can remove all person from danger, always pull the alarm and call to the your emergency number. If it is possible to contain the fire by closing doors and windows and extinguish the fire if you are well trained. If you can't able to do that, then normally as per the any norms like NABH or JCI, we have to say code red and the location name three times to raise the alarm. Now, as I say, pull the alarm. If someone wants to use the fire extinguisher, to pull the alarm, pull the pin, aim extinguisher, squeeze the trigger and sweep the extinguisher from side to side, covering the area with extinguisher. Now, this type of ABC or class which we define, then this type of fire extinguisher which can use dry chemical power. Then in case of electrical equipment, flammable equipment, we can use DCP as well as CO2. So evacuation, we can have a evacuation. There are certain time fire alarm comes. So we can able to manage by our own team and security officer. Then in that case, no evacuation required. Sometimes it's required evacuation require of partial department or floor only. There we can do partial evacuation. In case like entire hospital premises or has to be taken out and keep it to some safer place in assembly area, that is called a complete evacuation. Now general instruction. So what happens that what we follow normally is that, so the fire exit awareness of, you should know, everyone should know what is the closest fire exit. Then we need to guide our patient and colleagues who are there in hospital. There should be fire exit signages should be as clear as that. That should work on UPS supply. So your entire area must have a, at least some light should be there on inverter or UPS which can work. Even if there is a no fire or there is no light, at least it can glow. So that can be possible. Then all the fire corridor room doors has to be closed. Then all the corridors, and we need to make sure that NSA traffic observation should not be there. Then department should have a torches so that if there is a to be used in case of UMS as well, raw power cutoff is there. And if patients are there, like what happens that in hospital setup, our own staff is there as well as patients are there. So in case of, we need to assure our patient in case of fire that there we have to inform that now the alarm has been turned on and emergency plan is effected and there is an ambulance of help to assist as needed. Cover mouth with wet mask or cloth to avoid inhalation smoke. Move in sitting position or crawl whenever required. Decision of evacuation is informed to the managing director by management person. What is the do's in fire alarm system is that, or maybe when there's a fire alarm and we have to evacuate the system, use fire staircases. Okay, there are some fire lifts are also available, which are like pressurized fire lifts are there. Or we can use either a staircase or like it is not mandatory in Maharashtra that to have a ramp everywhere, but in South there is a requirement of a ramp also. So ramp has to be dedicated there to evacuate the patient who are there in various area like ICU or any other where they cannot able to move themselves. So ramps are also required there, but it is not mandatory in Maharashtra currently. Then switch off light and AC, that is very important for, then close the door and windows, then stay calm, check office and toilet, all have to be evacuated, keep fire alarm clear from obstructive, keep fire staircase far from all obstructive. So we need to make sure that everything is like free to move around. Do not panic, do not enter back in fire area. So it's always there that most of the cases it is there because our parking area is there in normal there in basement also. Most of the services are there kept in basement. the most hazardous areas in basement is that transformer and DG, all these things is there. Most of in hospital are there in the basement, and it can create a huge impact on fire. So, and at same time, there is a parking area if someone is having two wheeler or four wheeler there. So we have to teach our own staff that in case of fire, they have to come out of the building. They have to find out the nearest fire exit path, and they have to come out of the building and go to the assembly area. Do not use lift that time. Then do not keep any other garbage in hospital basement or service floors, which can create an issue, because these are the areas which can catch the fire. Then do not allow to run electrical equipment when not required. Do not use oxygen cylinder improperly. Never remove fire extinguisher for any purpose except emergency. Now, these are daily headcount. So what happens that in case of when we are doing evacuation, we have to move fast. We cannot stay there and we cannot do the headcount that time. So everyone has to carry disturbance. Like this is the problem what we are using our organization. Like this is a daily headcount. We keep it. So whenever someone is going to the assembly session, their HR department will be able to find out that who are there in morning shift and whether those people are there at assembly area. So it always becomes easy that to just find out whether anyone is get trapped in a hospital or not in fire. So it is always easy to keep this to a head count. Then like ambulatory patient, we see that ambulatory patient, if there is a security person or senior person on the floor, we'll inform to them about the evacuation. We will direct them how to go out or how to evacuate that area. And patients are can be escorted by the staff members to the assembly area or department like dialysis, OPD, or pathology or radiology. But there are substable patients. This patient can be evacuated with the help of wheelchairs, stretchers, ensuring that all safety precautions like putting on bed rails, fastening belts on wheelchair, we can able to, without harming that patient, we can able to transfer them or take them to the assembly area. This patient shall be transferred with the help of relatives, security guard, or staff around. Now, senior staff on the floor or areas shall monitor or guide the evacuation process and ensure that patients are not being left unattended. Transportation and evacuation of patients should be done on priority basis. Arrange for housekeeping staff, stretcher, or biomedical equipment or shifting out the patient. Provide adequate drug and medical equipment to the support to each patient during transportation. Then relatives of patient evacuated from the areas will assemble at assembly point. So now one more thing, which is very, very important now, ventilator patients or neuro cases or pediatric cases where patients are not movable. So how to tackle the issue during the fire alarm scenario? So like ambu bags can be used, are used basically for ventilator patient while transferring, or there are some new transport trolleys are there which can be used, or spine case, mobile spine board can be used while transferring. We have experienced in our hospital, the patient is rolled in blanket and we have taken it up to the safe location. So infant can be cradled in the arm, or two infant can be cradled at a time. So all these internal stretchers and everything should be available in case of emergency if you want to transfer the patients in the emergency session. Now, doctors of critical care unit shall accompany on patient on stretcher while evacuating. This patient shall be transferred after all patients from the respective units are transferred. So critical care patient will be transferred later on. Again, when the respective unit, all the other patients get transferred, then we have to transfer, because there will be, we have to be very, very careful while doing this activity of evacuation of patient. So thank you from my side. And Hello. Hello. I lost my signal. Hello.
Yeah, Nilesh, we can hear you. We can hear you.
Yeah. So this was from presentation side. Now, if someone is having some queries regarding. Hello.
Nilesh, we will take the questions afterwards.
Yeah, anyone is having questions?
Questions will be taken after the other two speakers have spoken. So thank you very much for the wonderful presentation. I think fire is one weak point for most of the hospital owners, and sometimes it is a challenging position because they would have acquired the building according to the location, and it may not fit into the fire thing. So that your points are well taken, and I think there will be a lot of questions because potential hospital owners are all asking about the fire. So there will be a lot of questions, and we will come back to you. Thank you. And we will introduce the next two speakers. I have the pleasure of introducing the next two speakers. Dr. Anu Kaushik is one of the rare fields in India, I should say, because we have a lot of nurses. We are known for export of nurses, but we don't have many nursing leaders like Anu Kaushik. He is a very few leaders in India. Finished her graduation of BSc nursing from university. After that, she finished her College of Nursing University. She is one of the very few nurses, as I mentioned, has done the PhD nursing in MMU, and she has got nursing excellence certification. Currently, she is working as a nursing director in Cloud9 Group of Hospitals for all our 25 branches all over India. In the past, she has worked in Columbia Asia and Fortis and Max Health. So she is very, very experienced, and she is an authority on the nursing issues, if I can say so. And we'll be very pleased to hear her. And following that, we have Dr. Shilpa. And Dr. Shilpa again comes with a rich background, and she has a dentist background. She has done BDA. She is also Dr. Shilpa, and she has done post-graduation in hospital management and general management degree from IIM Bangalore. She has done the executive MBA from IIM Bangalore, if you want to call that. And she has got over 10 years of experience, out of which she has been associated with Cloud9 for the last 8 years. She is currently working as managing the important Bangalore. She has definitely done a very good job, and we will be very pleased to listen to both of them with the rich experience they have. Over to you, Anu.
Thank you, Dr. Kishore, for the warm introduction. And I must thank the NNF organizers for giving me this wonderful opportunity. And as Dr. Nilesh said, that when you are preparing for a content or a presentation, you know, no matter how much you know, but there is always, you know, lots of learning. And I think that extremely holds true for me as well, because when I was trying to put my learnings and my experience into the presentation, trust me, a lot of learning has, you know, gone by. And I would like to thank especially Dr. Kishore for giving me this wonderful opportunity. So the topic that has been assigned to me is establishment of a CSSD, and we know that, you know, I'm talking about the healthcare workers, doctors, nurses. We all know that, you know, CSSD is an important, you know, department in the hospital, and but little do we know, you know, what actually goes behind in, you know, building a CSSD. I remember during my, you know, college time, I'm talking about my BSc or a master's nursing program, I have never learned about, you know, what are the flow requirements, what are the machines that goes inside, how do you calculate, what are the temperature regulation. The only thing that I learned was that CSS is a department where you send, you know, dirty things and you get them back, you know, sterilized. So that is all that I have learned. But trust me, with 24 years of experience in nursing, you know, having commissioned couple of hospitals, I would say the CSSD is one of the most important department, and it has got multiple dimensions, you know, to, you know, look into when you are designing a CSSD. And when I'm presenting my index, I'm sure many of you must be wondering, like, how do I cover all of this in, you know, in 30 minutes time that has been assigned? I've tried to put all the possible dimensions that are critical to designing a CSSD, and I'm going to briefly, you know, glance through them so that, you know, you have an idea when you plan to open your hospital that these are the some of the things that, you know, that are important and critical to be kept in mind. However, this list is not exhaustive. I'm sure there would be many more additions, but this is what I could gather from my experience and, you know, and also, you know, from the experts, and I'm sure that there will be a lot of learnings. So we know that CSSD is often called as heart of the hospital. I think for a very simple reason, because it functions like a heart, and we know that the function of the heart is to, you know, purify the impure blood. Similarly, I think the CSSD does a similar job. You know, all the dirty things come to the CSSD and they go out absolutely spick and span and clean and sterilized. So why is it that CSSD is critical? Because we know that if the CSSD does not maintain the quality standards, so, you know, the things are not going to be, the instruments or the devices that are going to be used on the patient, they're not going to be clean, and which is going to be, you know, grossly responsible for causing the healthcare associated infection. And we know the deadly, you know, VAEs, SSIs, the UTIs, CLEBSIs, and we know that each of these deadly infections results in extra patient stays, and there are documented studies which talk about a UTI can actually result in a 1 to 4 extra days of patient stay in the hospital. A surgical site could result in 7 to 8 days, and a bloodstream infection can result in 7 to 21 days, and a VAE can result in more than 30 days. So it's got a huge importance, you know, in the hospital, and more, you know, when getting an infection is one major component, but then, you know, there are other, resources of the hospitals, come into play. You know, we have loss of man hours because the doctors and patients, you know, they are, you know, just doing something which was totally preventable. It causes mental agony. It causes significant economical loss. There are poor surgical records. And I think, now there's a lot of litigation also that's going on in the country. So I think it's very important that we realize that CSSD is absolutely an important department and has to be really paid attention to. So let's begin with the designing of a CSSD. And I would like to start with this, one of my favorite lines, which says that if something is worth doing, it is worth doing well enough to meet your goals. And this purely applies to designing a CSSD. You know, what has been my experience is in most of the hospitals wherever I have even gone for audits, CSSD is all, you know, is a afterthought process. You know, when you create a hospital and you say, okay, now where do I create, you know, my CSSD? But I think it should be the other way around. The CSSD planning should actually start from the inception of the hospital, because there are so many gamuts to the CSSD development, you know, and the inputs from, you know, the facility engineer, biomedical engineer, even the equipment that you're planning to buy. You know, so you get those vendors, you know, from the beginning of your, you know, inception or planning, because they will be able to tell you, okay, let me give you an example, like a ETO. If you have to put a ETO in your CSSD, then you should know, okay, the exhaust line has to go out. From where does it go out? You know, this it has to be 7 feet higher than, you know, the surrounding building. So am I choosing the right place? Will I be able to, you know, pull out that kind of an exhaust line? So these are small things, but will have a major, you know, importance in your planning, because otherwise you will be ending up doing a lot of constructions and breaking, and then you will really regret that, you know, why I did not, get the right people in planning from the beginning. And there is also one important thing, that one size does not fit for all, and the CSSD has to be designed and customized according to the setup that you are planning. So maybe, for example, if you know somebody who has got a 100-bedded hospital and has, you know, come up with a CSSD plan and a design, and you think, okay, this is something, you know, which is readily available and I can probably, copy the same design, but it may not hold true, because it will totally depend upon the kind of building structure you have, the kind of, you know, services that you're going to, you know, render, the, you know, the work volume, the man hours, or, you know, the number of shifts that you want to, you know, run. So we are going to talk about all of them in detail, but this is something that I think it's really worth thinking about it. And the last piece of advice is a cheap, quick solution is generally a shortcut to chaos. So I think even when you get deeper into, you know, CSS redesigning, you will see that there will be a lot of recommendation from the vendors, from a lot of people that, you know, let's start at least with this, and, you know, and maybe, you know, later on we can, you know, devise and, you know, improvise. But this really doesn't work out, you know, well in case of a CSSD. And suppose you are planning to start like a 150 bedded hospital or a 350 bedded hospital, and initially you want to do it in a phased manner. Like you want to start with a 50 bed and then probably, you know, ramp up to 100 or 150 at a later stage. It would always be advisable that you allocate adequate space for CSSD in the beginning, and you can have basic shell structure, and you can, you know, put the, you know, the live equipments, you know, at a later stage when you actually start your hospital, you know, in a bigger way. But having this shell structure and leaving it as it is going to be very, very, you know, beneficial and fruitful in the long run. So let's quickly talk about, you know, how did this concept of CSSD came in, and it goes back as, you know, as late as 1920. The first CSSD was set up in American College of Surgeons, and the first CSSD that we got in India was in Safdarjung Hospital in New Delhi, and that was in 1965. So I think the benefits of CSSD, we've talked about it, but I think having a central place where everything gets cleaned, you know, under a common set of protocols, where the uniform standards of practice are there, there is maximum utilization of human and material resources rather than, you know, 10 people doing same task at different location, it doesn't help out. And also it eliminates costly duplication. The structure of the CSSD will purely be, you know, determined by the size of the facility, the kind of operations or the workload that they have, and where do you actually want it to be, you know, situated, the staffing, and the money that you have in your hand. And we will talk about each of them now in detail. So just to give you a broad understanding of how does the workflow in CSSD flow, this slide is very important because the entire CSSD planning will actually be, you know, determined by these, you know, workflow areas. So we have the accessory areas. Accessory areas are nothing but your reception area, your staff change room, you know, the reception bay, and your store where you know, keep all your materials. So that is being referred to as an accessory area. And then we have the decontamination area. Decontamination area is where you get all the contaminated area, and they are being, you know, decontaminated in this area. Cleaning and decontamination happens here. And then they move on to the next stage, that is inspection, assembly, and the packing area, where they're being inspected for, you know, the breakages, the quality, the, you know, the cleaning, everything. And then, you know, they are being packed in the relevant packing material. And then they move on to the sterilization area where they're getting sterilized. And then finally, the last point is that they are being stored. So this is how typically a workflow in the CSSD would happen. And if you see, you know, the one principle that really applies to CSSD is that the soiled and the sterilized zone should never crisscross each other. That means you should not be able to move into, you know, in these zones, you know, by crisscrossing. So it should always be a linear movement. But sometimes it may not be possible to have this kind of a design. So the another favorite design that has come up now is a U-shaped design. If you see in this layout, you know, the entry is from the soiled region, and then it goes into the, you know, the washing area and the decontamination area, and then it moves on to the, you know, assembly area, the packing area, then sterile area, then storage area and issue. So this U shape actually has been, you know, very effective way of, you know, maintaining the basic concept of, you know, having this zoning, and they are also not cross, they're not, you know, crossing each other's, but because sometimes linear structure really doesn't, you know, is possible because of the constraints of the building. Now, the size of the, you know, how, how big should be your CSSD is an important question, and I'm sure that this will be an important thing that will bother you. So there are a lot of guidelines given, and the broad guidelines is that for any hospital which is less than 100 beds, the thumb rule is almost 10 square feet per bed. And if you see, as you move up in the in increasing the number of beds, the area requirement per bed actually decreases. So for a 50 bedded hospital, then you can just multiply it by 10, so 500, and then we have a 15 to 20 percent extra margin that we keep for a better zoning and for other administrative work. So the size of the CSSD is first determinant is on the number of beds. Second is on the number of surgeries that you have, the workload that you have. What is the policy of single use device? So if you are having too many devices, the policy is like single device use policy is quite robust, then probably you will have less work coming to CSSD. Then does your endoscope reprocessing happens in CSSD? Then accordingly, you will have to cater to that additional requirements. What are the cleaning methods of reprocessing? And what are the type of sterilizers and the number of sheets that you plan to have in the hospital? So having talked about the the general area, so now this is just a very interesting table that I thought will help you to understand. So for example, for a 50 bedded hospital, like I said, 500 having a 15 to 20% extra margin, so your rough area will be 620 square feet. So if you have a this table talks about how your area is being divided into different zone. So similarly for a 50 bedded hospital, 100 bedded, 200, 300, and so forth. So this and the subsequent slides actually give you a very broad idea. How do you, if you've got 100% area in hand, how do you actually allocate the broad into a broader percentage? So decontamination area will actually consume 35% of the total space that is available at hand. Then your inspection, assembly, and packing area would take another 35% of the total area. Your storage area will be approximately 20%. And the 10% is your support or the accessory area that you have. So this is how you are going to broadly classify the 100% area that you have at your hand. So the next question would be, where do I have my CSSD? It is always advisable. It should be as close, to emergency ward, operation theater, and labor room because you have the maximum movement of equipments, instruments from these departments. So it makes sense, that it will result in lesser, your manpower being wasted less, and time is being saved, and there is easy movement of the instruments. And then your CSSD should also have adequate water, steam, and compressed air availability. And in some of the hospitals, they also have a provision wherein the sterilized store, one of the windows actually also opens up into the OT. So that, whenever there is a requirement, they do that so that, there is a constant supply of, sterile equipments from CSSD to OT. And this is primarily seen in hospital where they have a very high load of OT cases. So I have also tried to put in what is it that you would require according to the areas. So now this is a list of equipments that we would require in an assembly area. It's primarily your tables, trolleys, cabinets, your telephone connections, and your personal computer. So, and this is mainly the things that you would require in equipment, this assembly area. Then in the cleaning and the decontamination area, you will need a washer disinfector. You will need, it is highly recommended that you opt for a three-section sink where you soak the instruments first, then they go for washing, and then the final stage, the rinsing. And there are also dimensions available for the sink, what should be the, height and the depth and, the width of the sink, when you are installing them. Then there should be a provision for hot and cold water, the solutions, air guns, especially, when you have to dry the catheters or, where the lumen is, very narrow. And steam, hot air, ovens, wall fixtures, and emergency eye wash area in case you have a spill here. In case of inspection and packing area, it is primarily your magnifying lights, heat sealers, instrument storage and repair boxes, transfer carts and processing trolleys. In case of sterilization area, you definitely need to have the sterilizers, your autoclaves, your ETOs, loading carts, your heat resistant gloves, your sterilizer cleaning supplies, you have provision for record keeping and hand washing facilities. And the most critical area is your sterile storage area, where all the effort that you have done so far is going to be, you know, resting there. So the concept is now it has to be open shelving and 2 inches. So there are specific guidelines, you know, how should you place your shelves. So they should be 2 inches away from the outside wall, 8 to 10 inches above the floor, and 18 feet from the ceiling fixtures, because these dimensions will actually help you to prevent the entry of the pathogens, and also the distance from the ceiling is also being recommended because we don't want moisture because of the condensation. And very important thing, and this as have been auditor, I have seen that this one common practice which is absolutely a no-no is don't keep any cartons in the sterile storage area, because cartons are a big source of infection and they should never be placed in a sterile storage area. Another important parameter that needs attention is the pressure gradient, and we will talk about it in little detail because this is very crucial. Because if you see the 3 zoning that we have done, the most important area is our sterile area, and we have to have a positive pressure in sterile area. We don't want contaminated air to come inside our sterile storage area, because our sterile instruments are being kept here. So the gradient pressure is, as you move from sterile zone downwards, it starts becoming negative, and this is something that has to be really taken care of. And as I said, that CSSD is cannot be I think designed without inputs from all the stakeholders. So everybody will have their own set of important inputs, and it will always be advisable that you start them and involve them from the beginning and have monthly meetings with them, because each they will be able to give you inputs from their own perspective department. Then there are other general requirements for infrastructure, that is you should have room and lockers, and you should also have provision for shower and toilets. There should be washings that we've talked about, and the paint should be antifungal. That's something that needs to be kept in mind. And floors and walls should be constructed with washable material that do not release fibers or particles, because they are going to come in contact with a lot of chemical agent, because we have a cleaning protocols and we don't want them to shed off and release fibers or particles which become a source of infection. And the flooring can either be vinyl or epoxy flooring. And something interesting that is coming up is on the coloring of the the tiles. So the red tiles are being used for decontamination area, so that kind of gives you an alert, that this red area is a decontaminated area. Then you can have a blue area for your packing area inspection, and then you can have a green area where your sterile items. So this visual demarcation actually helps people, to become more alert when they are moving on from one zone to another. And carpets, wooden and porous structure material are an absolutely no-no in CSSD. I'm sorry. Yeah. So there is, we know that there are a lot of machines that are, working 24/7. If you have a 24/7 CSSD running, then we need to have a very stable and uninterrupted electrical supply, because it will definitely hamper the workflow. And high quality material should be used, and preferably copper. And because if there is any compromise on the quality, it will be responsible for a fire outbreak. And we have already discussed and seen what fire can actually do in a hospital, and as explained by Dr. Nilesh. And the supply requirement is also being mentioned for the CSSD. Then we need to have provision for compressed air. Minimum 7 bar air pressure should be available. And an important thing is that the walls, should be of utmost premium quality, because they have to actually handle high pressures. And if any of these walls crack, then it will result in bursting of the equipments and will result in fatal accidents in CSSD. Water is a very important component, and I would say that probably the most critical element. And it is advisable that we use RO water, because we know that RO water is free from minerals, and it increases the lifespan and performance of the equipment and the spare parts, and also it facilitates a robust cleaning process. And there are some recommendations being given for the quality in terms of hardness, TDS, pH, temperature, and pressure. So I was talking about the airflow, the pressure. So in this table, if you see, we have actually put down the different functional areas that are there in the CSSD, and then we also given you recommendations for the air, the air pressure, what should be the temperature in these areas, and what should be the humidity in each of these areas. An important thing that needs to be really taken care of is in CSSD, the humidity, especially in the sterile storage area, should not ever exceed 70%, because higher humidity means more moisture in the air, and which will be responsible for fungal growth. So please keep these guidelines in mind while you are designing the CSSD. Now, there are also lightning requirements as given by AMI standard, that is American Association of Medical Instrumentation. So there are basically European guidelines and AMI guidelines, which give a lot of directions for CSSD designing. And it says that you cannot have a uniform lightning all across CSSD. And what they say is that a person with age of 40 to 40, 55 years would require an average amount of illuminance, whereas a person with 55 years of age would require highest amount of illuminance. And if you see the table down, we have also classified, according to the function, what kind of illuminance you would require. So it starts with least, that is the minimum that you need to have, an average, and the highest illuminance. And this classification you can actually apply in the department depending upon what is the age group of your people, what is the seniority level. But definitely you cannot go below the least illuminance guidelines that has been given for a specific area. And if you see closely into this table, you will see the maximum light that is being recommended is in the inspection area. That is detailed inspection. So even for the least illuminance, average illuminance, and highest one is for the inspection area. Manpower requirement. It would definitely be advisable to have somebody who has gone through a diploma program in CSSD management. And if possible, try to take science graduate people, because they will have better understanding of infection control practices, it has been seen that they are better equipped to handle CSSD. And the number of CS, the staff will actually be totally dependent upon what is the workload of the hospital, how much automation you are using in your department, and what is the number of shifts that you would want to, you know, run in the hospital. And it is not recommended, or I would say it is totally your choice, you know, how do you want to run your hospital. If you think that the workload is very high and you need a 24/7 manning, you can plan accordingly. And what I have learned from my experience, that many a times we do get, you know, stuck up in emergency situations where the CSSD is not being, manned 24/7, but then you have, you know, very critical or emergency cases coming up in, especially at night time, where you need some very important instrument which needs to be sterilized, or there are multiple cases, you know, and you are only, you know, equipped to handle two or three cases. So how do you manage this? So what one of the ways that I have managed this situation is to train all the OT technicians also in running the sterilizers. So so that, you know, in case of any emergency, we should not be totally dumbstruck. We should have people who will be able to operate this machine. So this cross training of OT technicians to man the CSSD, I think it has really worked out well. And if possible, I would also suggest that, you know, you could also look at it. And other than that, you know, the CSSD technician, you also need to have the people who are handling the maintenance services, the biomedical engineers, and the housekeeping staff. So this is something really interesting that I learned myself while preparing for this presentation. So this is a color vision test. So the question is, what number do you see? So I really do not know. I know, is the image too distorted or too stretched? But you can actually, if you can make out some number, there is some number, you know, which is a dotted number in the middle. So congratulations to all the people who are able to see 5, because 5 means you have a normal color vision. And if you are able to see 2, then I'm sorry, then that it seems that there is a trouble with you, your color vision. So it's a very important test. I think we are not doing this test. It is a test which must be done for all the people who are going to work in CSSD, because they are going to deal with a lot of colors. And if you see in the next slide now, all the quality indicators that we will have, the biological, the chemical quality indicators, they will show a lot of color changes. And if you're going to have this color, then you will not be able to appreciate those changes. And if you're not able to see those changes, then you will actually, may not be able to understand whether the indicator was a successful one or was a failure. So it's an important test. Yeah. So now some of you have questions on how many sterilizers should I buy, how many wash disinfectors should I buy, how do you actually decide the quantity. So it is important that the equipment in the CSSD should be sized in an appropriate manner according to the load that you have in the hospital. And also the number of OTs that you run will be one important parameter. And then we will also be looking at, if suppose you have got an option to choose, say, for example, a sterilizer, you have a requirement of, say, 16 steam sterilizer unit sterilizer, and you have options available. There is one which is 18 size, and there are one which is like 8 and 8. So which one would you choose? I would suggest you don't go for one bigger size. Rather than that, you go for 2 smaller ones, and you add up that, that takes care of your total capacity, because if one, runs down, you have a backup available. And sometimes you may not have so much of workload at one go, and you don't have to run your big, sterilizer every time. So this is something that will be of great help when you're, calculating your capacity requirements. So let's quickly do one calculation, and I will just help you to understand how do you calculate your sterilizer requirement in the hospital. So let's take, for example, this is a hospital which has got 250 beds, and it has got 6 major OT with 30 surgeries every day. and it's got 4 delivery room, which approximately I've taken a number of 40 deliveries per day, and you've got 20 ICU and CCU beds, 10 outpatient OPDs, and the working hours that we are looking at for this hospital is roughly 12 hours. So when we have got this baseline data, we always when we calculate, we take this a safety margin of 15% to 20% extra than the capacity. So this, you know, in case there is an additional requirement, we are able to manage it. And then we take a number of working hours in the CSST that I have said is, you know, we'll say 12 hours, and we take 1 hour per cycle, so that, you know, putting in the instruments, taking them out, and, you know, the autoclaving time. So one cycle, we are assuming it as 1 hour. So based on this input, so what I have mentioned there was, so you have made for every surgery intervention, or for one case, you would require 110 liters of steam capacity. So similarly, these are standard guidelines. For one bed, it is 50, for delivery, it is 54. For one bed, it is general bed, it is 6. For ICU bed, it is 12 liters. And for outbox box, it is 3 liters. And this term you remember right now, that is one ST standard unit is 54, which I will explain you in the subsequent slide. So just to help you to understand what I'm talking about, so in the first, in the previous slide, if you see, I have actually given you a breakup of the beds, right? So I'm saying there are 6 OTs with 30 surgeries. So I've given you a baseline data. In the next slide, I am actually telling you that each of these surgery will have 110 liters requirement for steam capacity. And similarly, I have done for others. So now how do we do the calculation? So I told you that I've got this 250 beds hospital. So for every bed, I've mentioned in the previous slide, it is 6. So 250 multiplied by 6, it is 1500. Similarly, for surgeries, for 30 surgeries a day, and for every surgery, you require 110 liters. So your calculation number is 3300. So for 40 delivery, for one delivery, you require 54. So 54 into 40. So similarly, we've totaled it up everything, and it comes out to 7230 liters per day. And as I said, that you can take 15% extra margin. So the total will come up to 8320 liters. Now, these liters, we have to convert them into standard unit, because the capacity of the sterilizers will act, it comes in the standard unit measurement. So what we are going to do here is, so the liters that I have got, that is 8320, I'm going to now divide them by 54, because one standard unit is 54. So by doing this, I will actually get to know what is my standard unit consumption requirement per day. So it turns out to be 160. And I'm saying that I've got 12 hours shift. So I'm saying that one hour will be a break time. I will run 11 cycles. So 160 divided by 11 cycles, it is, so that means I have a requirement of 14.5 steam capacity per cycle. So that is what is my rough estimate. Now the next slide, if you see, now you have options to choose from. So my requirement is 14.5. So I would actually, now I have got A sterilizer with 4 capacity, I've got B capacitor with 6, I've got C with 8. So how do I want to take it? Do I want to take 8 or 6, take a one of each? So the best requirement would be, since I have a requirement of 14.5, it is the best solution for me will be I take 2 sterilizer with 8 standard unit capacity, and this will help me to manage my CSSD requirement. So once I know my sterilizer capacity, now from this I can actually calculate what is the capacity of the washer disinfector I would use. So whatever we have calculated in the previous slide for the sterilizer, 30% of that, of that portion will actually be, roughly a requirement for a disinfector, and 20% approximately will be my rough estimation for a ETO capacity calculation. So once you have done this, a sterilizer capacity, then you can actually calculate what size of washer disinfector you need, and what is the requirement for ETU. So now this is something really, really, very interesting on how long should I actually use the items that I have in my sterile storage area. So I've just taken one example. This is not the right example, but just picked up from one of the hospitals where they use autoclave items for 1 month, ETO item for 6 months, and plasma items for 6 months. And if you ask me, is this right, or is it wrong? Honestly, I will not be able to tell you, because now this concept of storing items based on on a general principle that all autoclave items should be stored for one month, ETO for 6 months, is becoming really obsolete now. And what does CSSG now recommends is that now the hospitals have to switch on to an event related shelf life. So what does this mean? That is that the general principle is that the product shall remain sterile until some event causes the item to become contaminated. So if you are able to store your item as per the recommended guidelines, that means you've ensured that it remains sterile, there was no tear in the package, it did not become wet, the air movement, the traffic, condensation, temperature, ventilation, etc., everything was absolutely fine, then you don't have to adhere to these timelines. Because so that means your item will remain sterile as long as you are able to give that kind of parameters for it to remain sterile. So this is something that is is being tested, and is there are a lot of hospitals that I know are now going for a lot of research on this topic, is that for how long can I use an autoclave package, for how long I can use it for my ETU item, can I extend it beyond 6 months for ETU item, can it be 1 year. So it will totally depend on all these multiple factors that will determine how long your packet is going to be sterile. Flash sterilizer is an emergency handy equipment that you can have in your hospital. So you have your surgeon is doing an important procedure, and there is one instrument that just got dropped, and it's very critical for the surgery. So you just need something which can quickly disinfect or quickly sterilize. So you can use this flash sterilizer, because the autoclave cycle, the ETO cycles will take time. So this is something that is the best solution in the shortest available time, and that this should only be used when you have no other option available. You should know what is CSSD recall. CSSD recall is a process by which all the items that have been sent from the CSSD to the end users to be called back, as the name indicates, recall. So that means they have to be called back, and that recalling could be because of an indicator non-compliance, or where the sterilization quality is questionable, or the sets have become wet, moist, and torn. So I would like to share my experience here is like when you interview staff on what is CSSD recall policy, and when you ask them to show the document, they are able to actually show you a very well written document. But when you actually ask them, when did you do your last CSSD recall? Man, we have never done it. Okay, do you do mocks? Yes, we do mocks. So what do you do in the mock? So actually, when you're doing a CSSD mock or an actual recall happens, all the items that have been actually sent to different respective department have to be traced back by the batch number. And you have to have a reconciliation of from this load, the failure has come, and now these 10 sets have gone to these different departments. I have been able to get 7 of them back. So where are these 3 remaining? So if these 3 are being used on the patient, you have to track those patients for any kind of infection, for surgical site infection, if it was a dressing set that has been used. So you have an important part will be now to track now those items which have been used on the patient for the batch that was actually supposed to be recalled. And an ICN has a very important role in a CSST recall and tracking mechanism. There are newer concepts that are coming in CSST, and I just thought, and I really found it very fascinating, and I thought, let me just share with you all. There is a concept of super CSSD. Super CSSDs are like factory-like sterile services. So what happens is that they have got tie-ups with multiple hospitals. So they actually supply all the requirements of the hospital through this CSSD. So these hospitals actually now don't have a CSSD of their own in the hospital, and they actually have tie-up with this. This is a wonderful concept. They are manned by very experienced people. You have a very less, virtually no capex requirement, because all the instruments are actually are being owned by this super CSSD. You just have to give a requirement, and based on your monthly requirements, you will be charged an X amount. And then accordingly, you will see the highest standards are being maintained, and you can also decide on the turnaround time. And this model is actually working extremely well in France and England. And it's supposed to be a super successful model. And we are hoping that we'll soon have it in India as well. Then there is another important thing that we should know, that there are three important quality controls that we monitor in CSSD. That is a physical control, that is being displayed by temperature, pressure, and gas concentration. Then we have chemical indicators, where the easiest way to explain is when you have those strips which are being put on the packs. So when there is a color change, it indicates it has been successful. And we have got six class of chemical indicators, and out of which this Bautic, the class 2-1, is not a sterility test. It actually checks for the air pockets or the air leaks, but the remaining check for sterility. And the last one is a biological indicator. And so we use different types of bacillus, this geobacillus Aspergillus for steam, and bacillus atrophius for EGO, and these are very good indicators. But the problem is that they take pretty long time to show the results. But the good news is that there is now the rapid technology which has come in now, which is which can actually give you the results for the biological indicators in 1 hour, 3 hours, and 4 hour intervals. They basically actually test the activity of the bacteria, and you will actually, if this is successful, then actually your CSSD recall problem can be addressed to a very large extent, because then you can actually wait for a biological indicator result to come out, and then only you dispense your other sterile equipments to the other departments. So this is what I was talking about. So they actually test the activity of the bacillus. It is important that we should understand that there are some occupational hazards which are associated with working in CSSD. Of burns, and then there are a lot of ergonomics problems. I think I've got lost on my presentation. Just give me a second. Yeah. So there are issues with a lot of noise, because a lot of machines running in radiations. EGO has a lot of detrimental effect on our health. It is supposed to be, it sometimes seen is carcinogenic. It causes cataract. It results in abortion. So there are a lot of side effects associated with EGO. You are dealing with a lot of sharp injuries. There's chances of trips and falls. And you are working in high temperature. There is heat, stress, burns, and you're all the time working with water. So there is a chance of dermatitis. Now, what are the next question will be, what are the guidelines, you know, the various accreditation bodies, you know, talk about? So NABH and JCI basically, you know, they talk about four important parameters, which are almost similar. They give you, you know, they give guidelines for infrastructure requirements that we have covered. Then they talk about the various processes, documented processes, and their implementation on ground. Then you know, the education of the staff on the, you know, whether, you know, they are aware of these processes, how are they implementing, what is, are they aware of the safety protocols, and then, you know, the quality indicators, what, you know, what are being, what are monitored in the CSSG, what is the documentation, and is there a compliance issue. So some of you may have question on you know, is it a must to have a CSSG in the hospital? You know, if you are able to, you know, tie up with a CSSG setup which is, you know, which is in close proximity to your hospital, which ensures that, you know, the quality standards are maintained, where you can go and check regularly, you know, the adherence to the processes, and you maintain your record, there is no problem, and you can actually do the tie-ups with, you know, nearby hospital or the CSSCs that are, you know, doing this task. And so this was one of the interesting studies that I thought I will conclude with. So this was a study where, you know, the calculation of the capacity and what is the cost of setting up a CSSD sterile department for a 1500 bedded hospital that was being done in a tertiary care institute. So so this is how, what I explained to you, like they did the calculation on the number of, you know, the procedures, and then same calculation, the one that I explained to you, you know, the calculation of sterilizer, E2, and the washer disinfector requirements. And this is interesting, two tables are interesting. So some of you would be interesting to know, you know, what will be the cost. So they have actually, you know, listed down item-wise equipment details with the unit price, you know, the grand total that they have done for that hospital. So, and they've added the table, and the value is quite, you know, interesting. It's a large volume, but purely because it depends upon what kind of equipment you want to use, what kind of automation you want to use, what is the brand that you want to use. So these will have a lot of implication on deciding on your cost factors. So, and you can do a similar exercise for, you know, for the number of beds or the number of sterilizer, washer, disinfector, and equipments for your hospital. So to conclude, as you've seen that designing CSSG is not simple, and we need to, you know, have a lot of experts in, you know, in consensus while designing the CSSG, and plan for the future when designing. Don't have a very short-term vision, and the success of this CSSG design is completely dependent upon how well you understand the CSSG process. And for all those who are, you know, aiming for setting up your own hospitals, wishing you all the best, and please start preparing it for, from today, so that you have a bright and a successful future. And I know that the content on the PPT was quite a lot, so I've written down my email ID on the slide, and if any of you want this presentation to be mailed to you, I will gladly do that. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Anu. Wonderful. It's one of the most difficult areas of the hospital building, and it's always underestimated. Personally, I can tell from my Cloud9 experience that we had to revise CSSD of three hospitals after a few years. So Anu has virtually covered what all can go wrong, what all can be fixed by good planning. And the most important point which she said from experience is very clear. When you have a CSSD technician who goes off sick or on leave, you need to have the OT technician trained to work as a replacement. I think Anu's presentation will expect a lot of questions. So please bear with us. we'll invite the next speaker, Dr. Shilpa. As I introduced earlier, Dr. Shilpa is quite experienced zonal manager with Cloud9. And when we gave the topic of linen versus disposables, there's not much of literature evidence available. So I told her to prepare from practical experience. And this is very, very important because a lot of cost comes into picture. The choices of the doctors comes into picture. Dinakar, it's very important factor for you to listen. Over to you, Dr.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much, sir. I would love to thank Dr. Kishore for this opportunity and these kind words, and NNF as well for giving me this platform to share my little experience and views on linen and disposables in a hospital setting. So let's get started in the interest of time as well. Just give me a second. Yes, before we could actually see and look into weigh the pros and cons, weigh the advantages, disadvantages of linen and disposables in a hospital setting, let's take a look at what does this actually cover. Like in a hospital setup, the list of disposable products are plenty, ranging from surgical gowns to drapes to shoe covers to head caps. There are in fact newer range of products which is available, like bed linen and uniforms also, which has been making a mark these days with respect to disposables as well. We've ideally seen linen uniforms and bed linen, but of late the disposables also are coming into picture and making their mark. With respect to linen, linen can be broadly divided into direct, indirect textiles based on the use on patients. So direct linen, for example, would be the patient gowns, the OT scrub suits, the OT linen. So the OT linen forms a major basis of discussions for today's topic, that is surgical drapes to surgical table linen to surgical linen sets that is used during an operation. Indirect textiles, while they're not directly used on a patient, but it's mostly to do with the office linen, like curtains and upholsteries and bed linen, in fact. Professional textiles consists of uniforms and aprons used by staff and doctors. So what is better, disposables or linen? This is a much debated topic as to, which is superior, what is recommended, which one to choose. So let's look at the major factors for consideration when it comes to making the choice between linen and disposables. The first most important choice, as Dr. Kishore mentioned, the cost comes into factor. The environmental impact being the second most important factor while we are considering linen or disposable. Third being infection control. Fourth, comfort and surgeon's choice. And operational ease. These are the five factors which would support us in making a decision as to which is better or which is recommended. So talking about the first factor and the most important factor being the cost. Well, all of us would like to want to see a greener bottom line at the end of the day as hospital administrators, as hospital owners. This is what we would strive for at the end of the day. Key advantage of reusability makes linen undoubtedly a very lucrative choice for hospital in terms of cost savings. When we look at these two tables down here, it is evident that the cost of a reusable linen would be much more higher than a disposable set. But eventually, over time, this cost is completely outweighed. So 850 rupees costing, a disposable linen costing 850 rupees would outweigh the cost of and advantages. The small snapshot of cost comparison between surgical linen set and disposable.
Lights are not moving.
Okay, give me a sec, sir. I'll just refresh it. Give me a minute.
And now we can see.
Is it visible, sir?
Yeah, it's visible. I think the previous slides nobody saw, so maybe just
run through once.
Just zip through the slide which you have spoken.
Sure. Starting with as to making a note of what are the different linen and disposables available in a hospital setup. This was the disposable and the linen classification basically is mentioned right here. And while talking about which is better, these are the five factors that we would come into consideration while making a choice as to which is better. The cost, the environmental impact, infection control, comfort and surgeon's choice, operational ease. So basis these five factors is what we will discuss in the future slides as to what is better. And this would help us making a decision now with this framework. So the first cost, the first factor being cost, as I said, bottom line is extremely critical. Sorry, sir.
The slide is stuck again.
Sorry. Better?
It's stuck on the cost slide only.
Okay.
Maybe stop sharing and start sharing again, then it'll work.
I just did that, sir. Okay. Is it visible right now?
No, not yet. The slides haven't come. Sometimes it takes 30 seconds delay in seeing. Yeah, now it's come.
These two tables?
No, one table has come. Yeah, now it's come. Sorry. Now it's come. Now it's done.
Okay. So when we look at these two tables, basically the cost of purchasing a linen set is much higher. But eventually the cost of cost of linen outweighs the cost of disposables. So small snapshot of working that we did in our hospital of a surgical linen set versus a disposable linen set. So a cost, as we saw, it's around 1,390 to create one surgical set, which is used for an hospital, which is used for a surgery. When we are calculating the cost per surgery of a set of linen, ideally speaking, the cycles or the lifespan of this particular linen plays a very important role. As per general medical textile industry standards and the experience what we have had, the life cycle or lifespan of a linen set lasts for about 50 to 70 cycles. So here, considering it at a lower cycle of 50 cycles, the cost of just the linen per operations would be around 28 rupees that I would spend. But this further this is not the final cost, absolutely. The cost of laundry, the cost of disinfection, sterilization, power, the water that I used for sterilization, all these costs coming into picture. A cost per surgery when I use just a linen set would be around 170 rupees. This, when I weighed against 850 rupees that I spend on a disposable set, technically results in around 80% of cost savings if I use linen alone versus disposables. I'll also give you another example of an actual case scenario, especially which happened during this pandemic times. We used to use a lot of disposable gowns, especially during the first month where we did not know about the in and out of the pandemic, how this particular COVID would, you know, treat everyone. We tried to keep our employees at the best of their safety and we used disposable gowns. But in a month, we realized that it is costing us heavy on our pocket, definitely, and not compromising this and at the same time ensuring cost savings. We changed or moved down to reusable gowns. These gowns were basically not our regular cotton gowns. These were treated chemically, which also had like an antimicrobial layer and found to be a better barrier for protection. So these gowns basically costed us 504 rupees, and the life cycle, similarly considering a 50 cycle span of this particular linen and adding on the laundry cost, the cost per use of these linen were landing up at 31 rupees per linen that I used versus 100 rupees that I used to spend. That's technically a savings of 70% on cost, and this across all our units helped us save around 3 to 4 lakhs per month just on this. While I'm talking about cost savings, only from an organization's perspective, it's not all when I'm talking about Pro Linen. It's about the end user as well. Keeping the end users as a key factor in mind, how does it affect them? It definitely has a better ease on the pocket of our guests as well. So if you can see the table right there, average cost of consumables for a patient that he spends when a surgeon uses only a reusable comes up to 8 to 9 thousand, whereas an average consumable cost for a patient whose surgeon does use disposables and not linen, that would be around 11,000 to 14,000. That's a savings of around 3 to 5,000 for a patient. And this definitely would help us have a competitive advantage on pricing when compared to, you know, using disposables. Along with this, there are also certain hidden costs when it comes to disposables. Disposables, sometimes we use more number of sheets to create a thicker barrier between the patient and the surfaces, end up spending more time and thereby adding cost. Also, these disposables are not as absorbent as our linen would be. And as a result of this, when there are procedures that involve fluids coming out into contact with linens, which are not absorbed and contained, they basically pool or trickle down onto the floor. This increases my cleaning time, cost, and also sanitary concerns would come up. Furthermore, if the quality of this particular disposable is not of good quality, they would shed more than a reusable linen and thereby increasing operational cost. While I'm talking about hidden costs of disposables, there are arguments pro disposables as well, wherein the cost of actually maintaining a linen would be much more, or the environmental concern that we're going to see further would be much more. But weighing all these overall, the hidden cost of disposables are seen to be much higher than what we see in a linen. Talking about as second most important factor for consideration would be the environment. Definitely reusables would be the answer for a healthcare organization who would want to be mindful of their environment, regards sustainability as a key element. So as they say, linen is definitely a responsible choice because future is not disposable.
Again, the slides are stuck at that slide only.
I'll probably have to keep doing this multiple times. Working, sir?
Yeah, now it's working.
So yeah, like I was saying, that reusables are definitely a choice if a healthcare organization would want to be mindful of their environment, be more greener, regard sustainability as a key element. So the reusables definitely have a lower carbon effect and are more sustainable and environmental savvy. There's a lot lesser waste that a reusable would create than disposables. So here the disposable companies, as I said, argue that there's also water and energy wasted when we are cleaning the reusable textiles. That's the laundry aspect of it and so on. But of late, the laundries with the newer technologies that have evolved and the environmental concerns or environmental regard that the laundry have, they basically reuse water, they pre-treat water, they post-treat the water before disposal as well. So that part of it, by all these things, they do negate the environmental impact of linen. So definitely linen has an upper hand with respect to environment. When it comes to environment, it's a more sustainable option for hospitals, I would say. Third important aspect would be infection control. In the late 1980s, there were concerns about spread of when HIV actually emerged. There were concerns about spread of bloodborne diseases, which prompted the shift from reusables to disposables. especially in the operation theaters. During those times, there were a few studies which suggested that disposables were superior in terms of infection control than reusable linen. But this was completely changed over time. There were many studies which proved that they were equal in terms of infection control. In fact, one of the studies done by American National Standards went a step ahead and proved that linen was superior by 70% in providing barrier protection than disposables as well. There are also these newer linen in the market, like I mentioned earlier, with antimicrobial properties. These are basically treated with ammonium compounds, silver, zinc, triclosan into the fabric, which makes it creates an antimicrobial layer as well. However, in case the infection control measures and the standards of infection control are not maintained, linen can lead to a lot of hospital-acquired infection, spread of infection, and affect patient safety eventually. So in case your organization does not have...
It's frozen again. Should I take control and move your slides?
Sure, sir, if you can.
Yeah, one second. So which slide are you talking now?
I'm at infection control, sir. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, done. It's there.
All right. So, however, lack of control, in case your organization does not have up to the mark regulation standards or a team who focus, disposables would definitely be a choice for such organizations. So we can move on to the next.
Yeah.
One slide prior, sir. So comfort and surgeon's choice, basically. The comfort aspect of it and the preference aspect of it, what we have seen is generally that the senior surgeons are more inclined towards the linen or the reusables versus the newer surgeons opting for disposables. And this could be because of multiple reasons of comfort, the temperature, the heat management, with respect to linen versus the disposables. Disposable garments also can be very difficult to attach to the patients and secure them. It takes a lot of time sometimes compared to the reusable linens. Also the absorbability aspect of it, the heat generated because of the barrier protection or the GSM or the kind of material that is used in disposables. Linen is far more the choice that we have seen, especially with respect to senior surgeons out here. Having said this, there are also latest advances which have come up in disposables that make it more comfortable than the previous. So they're more friendly to the skin and much more cottony that is developed of late that we have seen. So can we go to the next slide, sir? All mostly whatever factors that I've spoken is seems to be more pro of linen, but this particular factor of consideration, apart from the fact that with respect to reusables, it guarantees me a continual base of linen. So what we saw in the initial times of pandemic, wherein there was a crisis of availability of disposables, availability of personal protective equipment, in such cases, the linen is more manageable than the disposables. So considering that's the major operational plus point, but there are a lot of other negative points when it comes to linen, when we talk about operational ease, that I would say as an administrator or as a team that would lead management of this linen. So infrastructure requirements, for example, linen requires various areas. For example, I need a clean area, clean utility, I need a segregation area, I need a disinfection area, I need to store soiled linen, I need to have a specific process as well for managing the linen from the storage to transport to maintaining the linen. So the time and effort which goes in is definitely much more than what it is with respect to the disposables. So disposables are neatly packed, hygienically packed and ready to use, whereas there's a lot of time consumed for tasks with respect to the reusables. Also, the disposable gown supplied by vendor outside is much less subjective to incidental factors like loss or damage, whereas linen definitely needs to have a strict inventory control measure to be put in place to ensure that it is maintained. Also, as earlier mentioned, infection control measures need to be up to the mark while handling linen, which could otherwise lead to serious patient safety concerns. To the next. Yeah, summarizing our different factors for consideration as below. So as we can see, when it comes to cost and environmental impact, linen has definitely an upper hand. And when I talk about comfort and infection control, both of linen and the disposables are on par, wherein again, conditions apply for infection control matter with respect to reusables, as long as there are standards adhered to only. And with respect to operational ease, disposables definitely outweigh linen. So considering and looking at all these factors, take time to consider whether disposables is better for you or a reusable linen makes sense based on your operational needs, based on the needs of your organization, and then decide. Shouldn't be taken in a haste, of course. And if you decide to introduce it, do it gradually. And education becomes a key to making this shift. So a small brief on how you can make a choice. So we can go to the next. So how to make a choice, or when you're making a choice, what are the factors? So basically identify your allies first. So it's your infection control or infection prevention team who form the key. The doctors are very critical for this shift. Taking a buy-in from the doctors, educating your staff as to why this change is coming up, and reaching out. The next step would be reaching out to linen supply vendors, negotiating on the cost, negotiating on the specifications of your requirement. And next would be identifying your laundry who would cater to your needs, and checking on the standards of that laundry as well, what it's got to offer to your organization. Next would be to compare the cost and the processes which need to be put in place, coming up with a standard operating procedure, coming up with details of a process that needs to be put in place for further management, and then training your staff on the use, collection, storage, and managing of linen. Post this, it is suggested to do a pilot of reusables than getting on to a full-fledged shift completely at once. Do a pilot for probably 3 weeks or 1 month, whatever that would be necessary as per your needs. And post that, an implementation or evaluation needs to be done. Concerns need to be looked into, addressed, and then a call can be taken. Having said all this, it doesn't have to be an all or none model. I use completely disposables or I completely use linen. It can definitely be a partial mix. It could be a mix of whatever, 60-40, 50-50, depending on your doctors or surgeons buy-in. You could decide on a model for yourself as to whatever works well for you and accordingly take a call.
Thank you, Dr. Shilpa.
Thank you so much.
Wonderful presentation, and I'm sure nobody would have thought about cost saving and the difference. It was very, very educational, and I'm sure most of the audience, especially the hospital owners, will appreciate the lecture. And now over to Prashant Gowda and Prakash Vemkal for moderating the session. Prakash, are you there? Prashant, are you there?
Prakash sir has some family this thing, so that's why he's gone. Okay. He said if he's free, he'll join. Somebody had died in one of his relatives, so he'd gone there. Dinakar sir? Yeah. Yes, sir. I request our attendees if they have. Yes, sir. Kotrishi, sir.
Hello. Can you hear Prashant?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Go ahead. Sir,
can hear.
Hello.
Sir, we can hear you. Go ahead, sir.
Sir, it's a wonderful presentation. Regarding, I would like to comment on the effect of laundry. I would like to say, because most of the times in the hospitals we have got a different infections, either it may be anything, it may be, say, you can say bacterial, viral, or fungal. What is their comment is, disposable linen in hospitals in the rural and urban areas, how it differs from the rural and urban areas, whether it differs really. Hello, sir.
Shilpa, the question is, does the disposable and linen vary the usage, especially for infection control in rural and urban areas? Because they may not have all the facilities in rural areas. So Dr. Kotresha is asking, he's the president of NNFK and also he's the owner of Petals in
Hello, sir. Good evening. So I do not think it would be very different, because even in a rural hospital, they would definitely have certain standards for disinfecting their equipments or surgical items. And management of linen wouldn't be very different from, or sterilization of linen wouldn't be very different from that happens for a surgical instrument. So that is one thing that I would probably want to put in as to there wouldn't be differentiation. Second part is, it comes to infection control. There are a lot of studies which have proved that it is more or less on par. There is no difference that disposables have an upper hand or disposables are more secure in providing a barrier protection and not linen. They are considered on par with multiple studies across India and as well as abroad.
Thank you, madam. I would like to say, suppose it's a 100-bed hospital in a rural area, what is your for disposables? What is your idea for disposable unit you want to have?
So you're talking about the mix of disposable and reusable, sir?
Yeah.
Probably if the doctor, as Dr. Kishore mentioned, for us, the most important key, for us, we have 6 units in Bangalore itself. So out of 6 units in Bangalore, I probably have 2 or 3 units having reusable linen taken up to a greater extent. So the mix could be based on the doctor's buy-in. It could be an 80-20 rule. So in case I am extremely skeptical about the present situation of COVID, I would use those 20%. I would use disposables for those 20% cases and an 80% for reusables. Considering rural areas and the economical requirement of cost, or you know, controlling the cost or imbibing the cost, definitely better for them.
Thank you.
If any of our attendees have questions, they can directly unmute and ask our speakers.
Prashant, you can ask the panelists to say a few words.
Mr. Sai Bharani. Shivu. Mr. Shivu. I think our panelists were unable to connect. Mr. Shivu?
So, Mr. Nilesh, can I ask you a question? If I am constructing a moderate hospital in a tier 2 city and I have a budget limitation, I can't afford to have a sprinklers and various things. What is the bare minimum for fire safety? Would you advise considering the budget limitations?
No, Mr. No, that first of all is that mentality has to change. We should not take fire so lightly, but this is normally has been taken. Most of the people, when there is audit preparation, they make sure that that is there, available, but that should not be approach. The approach should be that should be ready for 365 days. It should be properly addressable fire system. Alarm has to be there, because just having alarm and controlling anything on the fire extinguisher is not so easy. Because if you see that most time, that fire extinguisher also we need to do regular checking of that, whether this is there, gas there, that also we need to check. As well as for the cylinder, we have to do hydraulic pressure testing also. Now, most times it happens that we meet every hospital will do that, because there is no person who can dedicated for this activity. They're putting someone there, but there's no person who is dedicated for fire safety process. So I personally feel that if someone is saying sprinklers are not there, I would not like that idea, because then we are taking chances every day. Because I understand that this will happen once in a blue moon, but when it happens, those people who have faced that issue of evacuation of patient is very difficult. So I would always like to have a sprinkler system, because there is no substitute for that. Because sprinklers are there for the hospitals, and if those are working conditions, and if they are on the proper automatic panel system, air panel system, which is the auto mode, then that is the best solution once the fire alarm. That is my personal opinion.
No, thank you very much, sir. That I think answered it very well, because most of the time the mindset of most people is it may happen or it may not happen. Why unnecessarily invest? It's considered as a dead investment. And that's why I asked you what you think, because as you rightly say, it's not a dead investment. When it happens, people wish they had that from the beginning. Prashant, back to you.
Yes, sir. There is one question which has come now. What is the overall cost for a 25-bedded hospital to install the fire system, legally appropriate fire system?
Okay, that depends on how much is the length of the sprinklers, and because with 25 beds, if that depends on the floor area, floor plate, but the panel is there, the firefighting panel.
They have a total built up, they have sent around 35,000 square foot, the total built up.
Okay, I will give like, if it is like around 3 lakh square feet area, give that example, the cost will be somewhere around entire system will be in the range of 2 crore.
2 crore, okay.
A fully loaded system without any compromise.
Sir, there is one more question which has come. We have installed the fire system, but every year there is a renewal. Yes. So how we should go about, because most of the time we need to give extra money to the fire people. How to handle this, first for NABH we have done it, but every year the payment, the cost comes out. How to take care of it? Is it really mandatory to renew it, or how it is okay, legally?
Okay, I will tell about Maharashtra. Okay, every 6 months we have to do third party audit. Okay, and those auditors are not charging more, they are just charging 12,000 per visit, and they are the authorized people from the Maharashtra government. Okay, they have to come and they will visit any location. They will miss. It has happened in our ward also. They told us to open a sprinkler. Because normally we do it basement. Everyone does in basement where there's a car parking is there. So they will remove the car. They will do these 3 meter and everyone will be happy. But now if some question come, because we know that, because in practicality, no one wants to do the patient evacuation. So no one wants to go undergo that scenario, the mock trial also. So it happens everything in such a way that we try to do it in the service area. But like as I told you, in Maharashtra, there is a compulsion is that every 6 months, we have to do it, third party audit, which is not charging, costing too much. And they will certify that when they come, like when they come on the June, they say that from January to March end, system was ready. The system was good for healthy system. They will never say that it will be ready or it will be useful for next few years. It's not like that. It is always 6 months what has happened. They will give a report for that. Now, what is important is that when we are saying whether we should pay or not, but then couple of things very, very important that from our side, this sprinkler testing and you should have monthly testing also for the fire extinguisher. We cannot say I'm having fire extinguisher at a place in the hospital and I'm having data ready with me that I'm having ABC 60 or DCP, I'm handed a cylinder. But if I don't know whether it's full or empty, because there is no BMS system for this to check that whether it's empty or full. So someone has to physically go there, see that it is empty or full. So that activity has to be done by someone there. It has to be, ownership has to be there. This is not only for the paperwork or for tick mark. This is for our own safety. If we don't care of own safety, then the question will always come that fire audit should be done or it should not be done. If you ask me, we should not think only for the audit 5 days prior to that. Twice in a year, 10 days and 360 days, we are in trouble. Should not land up in that scenario. At 360 days and for 5 days, I'm making everything ready only for audit purpose. That should not be the approach. We need to change our approach. That we have to pay for that. But yes, it is important to have that fire alarm system and detection system in place regularly, because that you need to also change that. Now there are pumps or sprinkler for that. And for the hydrant, there are pumps are there. If that bearings and everything get jammed, we cannot take charge on that day. That now it is fire alarm is activated and sprinkler pumps are not working, so there is no water coming. So then there is no use. You need to do that activity continuously. There should be some budget for that, allocation for that. Understand that in order to set up, someone will, because I am from medical engineering side, so I know that our first priority goes to medical equipments. Someone will say, why we are better read something and get a good ICU equipment. But that attitude has to change, because if a owner gets involved into that process and if they understand important firefighting, because something goes wrong, the first question asked the owner of the hospital. Mm-hmm. And he's in big trouble in that case. So he has to also understand there is an importance for firefighting. So irrespective of, because in India, you ask me for money is required, everything money is required. So then why we are like fighting only?
One more question they've asked is it mandatory for a fire alarm safety OC? Is it mandatory to get a OC and building insurance? I mean, basically, what they're trying to ask is if any mishap happens. With fire safety certificate, do we need to have an building insurance and OC as well?
Yeah, building insurance is always required for medical equipment, also for the property, also it is always required for lives of patients who are there. Building insurance is required, but the question which you asked, one more question you asked.
Mandatory to have OC for fire safety certificate.
Okay, now whenever we get a OC, then always there is a small asterisk mark there, the fire NOC has to be there. Now fire, once we get fire NOC, then only we get a regular OC for the building. Now, if you are not getting fire, because I've seen, I'm working on one project where higher NOC has given for 3 years, and it was in one state where it is written in Hindi, so no one understood that. It has been mentioned there that every year, means like if it is September, it has been issued, so it is valid for September 20th, then it is issued up to September 22, it is valid. But every year, on August month of every year, you need to give a undertaking that your systems are working. Now, every state is having different law. Like in Bombay, it is different. Bombay, it is like every 6 months, I have to give that third party. Other places, it is under your own declaration. So that depends on how most of people will take, okay, system is there, matters. If the smoke alarm is growing, that's okay. No one understands whether water is there or not in their system. And no one cares for that. That attitude, unless I think, change the attitude. So like we always say that desh badal raha hai, so it's time now. We have to think in that way. That fire is important. You cannot think. So after our incident, something has gone wrong, and then saying that it has gone wrong. Because I have seen that. So if you see, the short circuit happens. And it happens, like if you see the small fans, normally what happens in the air conditioning area, but those areas which are not air conditioned, they will use some fan there, ceiling fan or something like that, wall fan. If they are, you are continuing that on one fan, there are chances of short circuit. Now, if you do not have a time team, tackle that issue at that moment only, within that 1 or 2 minutes. Then once the fire starts, then it is nothing in your hand. So I understand sprinkler, everything is there, like people are thinking, and then you have to depend on the municipal authority of fire department. Because in the real sense, difficult to evacuate. Understand that, patient evacuation, for mock drill, whatever we do, it's not reality. When it comes to reality, those who are facing that issue, they know that what's the real trouble. Move the evacuate the ICU patient. It's very easy that removing, remove the ventilator, doing humbling, or if they are having 40 or 50 ICU patients at one time, it's not easy for everyone. So if it happens, you already having a shortage of, and how many people are ready to take that risk? Someone who will take the risk because they are able to take care of clinically, that is. So all these issues are there. So I will always prefer that better to take all these precautions from day one. We start hospital.
Thank you, sir. There is one question for Anu Kaushik. The thing is, what is the best place to install CSSD establishment, you know, for a 25-bedded hospital? What is the ideal thing in the hospital process?
As I said in my presentation also, the best place, you know, to install a CSSD would be as close to the place where you have the maximum workload. So if you have your OT, your LDR and emergency, you know, in close proximity, then I would suggest, you know, to have your CSSD, you know, close to these area, because these are the, you know, areas where you have your maximum workload. So logically, the direct principle is, it should actually be directly proportional to your workload, because that's the place from where you will have the maximum to and fro movement, and it's going to save you manpower, it's going to save time, and it will also ease the, you know, operational efficiency. So the ideal thing would be to as close to, you know, the place where you have, you know, the maximum workload.
There is one question for Dr. Shilpa. How much linen should be purchased for a 25-bedded hospital?
Okay, so basically with respect to the caseload, and when I talk about surgical linen, I can quote an example of my hospital where I do on an average 200 surgeries per month, and I have around 15 linen sets that I hold on to. So this is basically recycled.
Okay, so what they're trying to ask is, suppose if you have, what should be the spare we need to keep?
So it is generally 1:3 based on your load. Okay. If it's a 25-bed hospital, if it is a larger hospital, you can keep a load of 1:5 as well.
1:5. Okay. Kishore, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. I think these are the questions which I had. Attendees? Yes, sir.
No.
how much of training the OT technicians need to train them in the CSST, and will it have to be accredited?
See, since it's going to be an you know, internal job rotation, or I would say as an you know, add-on responsibility or a multitasking, what I have seen is that if a OT technician is being you know given a 2 hours training for a period of 3 months, they are pretty well you know hands-on on handling the machines, the equipments, the autoclave and the sterilizer, and this has come you know turned out to be very successful, and there is no need of you know a registration because we are not redesignating them as CSSD technician. We are just asking them to you know man a crisis situation you know if it arises, and we should not be having a situation where we kind of you know have cold feet, and they should be able to manage the situation. So a 3 months training with 2 hours daily rotation into the CSSD is pretty much okay to train them well.
I think Prashant, that's the question. we were gone over time also.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. yeah, I think we will conclude the session now. So thank you very much, our speakers, Dr. Nilesh Shinde, Mrs. Anu Joseph, Anu Kaushik. It is double N. I made a mistake and Kishore sir corrected it. and Dr. Shilpa. And this wouldn't have been possible without the help of Kishore sir and his network. So I think I'm sure this web session is going to, we are releasing it as a package, as a you know, complete package of how to start an hospital, what are the difficulties. And most of them have given mixed reviews and feedback. If so much is required to start an hospital, I'm happy working in wherever, whichever hospital I am, fire safety, CSSD and everything. But there are other people who have told that, you know, we are improving ourselves.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Tell yes, them sir. A marriage, it's all not romantic. Yes. Start getting hospital building is exactly like marriage. Only after marriage you will realize what are the other issues that can come up other than romance. So hospital is definitely not all rosy.
So they've given mix, sir. Both of them, few of them have dropped the idea of starting an hospital. They're happy with wherever they're working, and you know they're telling, I'm having time to spend with my family, my fixed timing hours. I'm happy with that. I thought of doing it after listening to all this. I've dropped an idea, but few of them have definitely got inspired, and they're working on improving the quality, and they're definitely you know got benefited with the series what we are doing. So thank you very much for your time and for your sharing your experience with all of us, and this we have already got a lot of feedback saying that you know most of them are unable to join because of multiple webinars which are happening, but we are getting a lot of views in our YouTube channel. This will be uploaded, but intentionally we are not uploaded now. Only after this series gets over we'll be uploading it. So thank you very much on behalf of NNF Karnataka State Chapter, from our President and Vice President and our entire Joint Secretary and entire EB member team and office. We would like to thank from bottom of our heart for sparing your time and sharing your experience. Thank you. Thank you. We'll conclude the web session. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.